want to introduce to you first Newell Bringhurst. He's an independent scholar and professor emeritus from the College of the Sequoias in Visalia, California. He's the editor and author of 12 books published since 1981. He served as president of both the Mormon History Association and the John Whitmer Historical Association. And his co-editor, Craig Foster, is a research specialist at the Family History Library in Salt Lake City. Craig has authored 6 books, 4 of these with Newell Bringhurst. And I have examples of most of them here. Craig's master's thesis was published by Greg Kofer Books, called Penny Tracts and Polemics, A Critical Analysis of Anti-Mormon Pamphleteering in Great Britain, from 1837 to 1860.
And you can see why it hasn't sold very well with a title like that.
But those are on sale for half price, $19.99, normally $39.95. Another that they co-authored together, The Mormon Quest for the Presidency, from Joseph Smith to Mitt Romney and John Huntsman. The other one that I don't have up here that Craig did is A Different God, about Mitt Romney and... remind me of the subtitle of that one.
That was about the 2008 Republican primary, Mitt Romney and the religious right going after Mitt Romney.
Thank you. I've got a copy here somewhere. Newell Bringhurst co-edited with John Hamer, Scattering of the Saints, Schism Within Mormonism. He is also the author of the biography on Fawn McCabe Brody, an excellent book, and along with Levina Philly Anderson, edited Excavating Mormon Pasts, the New Historiography of the Last Half Century. Some incredible books, a few that are out of print as well, and he also has a forthcoming book in November, I believe,
yes,
from the University of Illinois Press that is a documentary history of blacks in the church, so something to look forward to. Without further ado, I will just outline our program briefly. I'm going to start by hearing from Newell Bringhurst and then Craig. And then, by order of the contributors' appearance in the book, we will hear from Bridget Cook-Burch, then Barbara Jones-Brown, then Brian Hales, then Christopher Blythe, then Marianne Watson, then Eric Paul Rogers, followed by Shannon Spafford, and finally Patricia Scott. And then we'll have time for questions and answers. Any questions real quick before we get going? All right, turn you over to Newell.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
You'll notice I'm wearing my red shirt because I'm a graduate of the University of Utah, and I'm a proud Ute and always will be a Ute, and especially now that they've been ranked in the top 10. We can't say, well, I won't make any remark about the school to the south, but I'll let Craig handle that end. But so we kind of went to rival institutions, and we're often referred to as the odd couple of Mormon history. That was the kind of the designation that, I guess it was Bill Russell that kind of coined that term for us. And as Chris mentioned at the beginning, we've worked together on a number of book projects, and we've had a very good relationship, even though we come at some of this material from somewhat different perspectives. As Craig always likes to say, we try to keep each other honest. Anyway, I just, first of all, before I get into the presentation itself, I want to express both Craig and I's great appreciation and gratitude to Benchmark for allowing us the opportunity to discuss this third and final volume in our trilogy, The Persistence of Polygamy, subtitled Fundamentalist Mormon Polygamy from 1890 to the Present. As some of you will recall, the two of us discussed and signed copies of our previous two volumes of The Persistence of Polygamy. The first one, Joseph Smith and the Origins of Polygamy, and the second, From Joseph Smith's Martyrdom to the First Manifesto. On two previous occasions, in fact, it was at one of those that I met Barbara for the first time, and we managed to recruit her to do a wonderful essay for this volume. I'll have a bit more to say about that as we move on. And on a different occasion, I met Bridget. It was up at Weber State. We did a presentation up there. And so, you know, going around and giving these presentations has kind of exposed us and given us more, you know, very competent scholars to draw their expertise from and pushing this project forward. I want to acknowledge the other contributors who are going to give their, each of them are going to give a 5-minute presentation. There are eight. I assume all eight showed up, and I just as I mention your names, could you stand up and just so they know who you are and that they can identify you when it comes time to for your presentation and for the book signing. Bridget Cook-Burch, right there. She's did the foreword. Barbara Jones Brown did the opening essay in the volume. Brian Hales, and Brian Hales deserves special mention because he's not only done his own work in the area of polygamy, a significant body of work, but he's the only person that's contributed to all three volumes of this trilogy. And then Christopher James Blythe, where is Chris? Chris has actually done essays in two of the volumes, in volume two and now. He was one of the original authors that I recruited many years ago down at Chesner in 2009. I don't recall that meeting when I got him on board. And then Marianne Watson. Where's Marianne? Marianne's back there, and she has two essays in this volume, and I've gotten to know and appreciate the depth and the breadth of her scholarship over the years. And then Eric Paul Rogers, and he is, I've gotten to know him over the years when he lived up in Hamilton, Montana. In fact, he was the bishop of my stepmother's ward up there in Hamilton. And then Shannon Spafford, where's Shannon? Shannon has a special relationship to this volume. She is the daughter of the proud father sitting over there. And then last and certainly not least is Patricia Lynn Scott, a fantastic scholar in her own right, and we were just really grateful to have her come on board in these. So these will, all of these people in that order will give their presentations after Craig and I finish. Now, in my remarks tonight, I will focus on three questions that I would assume might be on the minds of those of you gathered here tonight. First, why yet another volume dealing with the much-written topic of Mormon polygamy, and in particular, fundamentalist Mormon polygamy? Second, what makes this volume different from previous studies on the topic? And finally, what motivated Craig and I to undertake the writing and editing of not just one, but ultimately three volumes on the larger subject of Mormon polygamy, besides being gluttons for punishment? I will attempt to answer the last question first. What motivated Craig and I to undertake what we did here? It has been this project had its origin some 7 years ago as a result of a number of papers given on plural marriage at the September 2008 meeting of the John Whitmer Historical Association in Boree, Wisconsin. And I heard a number of papers at that meeting. In particular, I remember the papers given by Eric Paul Rogers and Joseph Jessup. I'm sure you remember when we talked about that. It's hard to believe it's been 7 years. But following that meeting, the managing editor of John Whitmer Books asked me to organize and edit these papers that were presented at the meeting and into a single volume under the title, The Persistence of Polygamy. My original intent was to produce just a single edited volume of essays by a group of authors that would cover the whole span of polygamy, starting with Joseph Smith and going all the way through fundamentalist Mormonism. When I enlisted the services of Craig to work with me on this, I found that it was like topsy. It kept growing and growing. We continued to envision a single volume of essays, but as we began the editing process, we started having people approach us and say, would you consider maybe an essay on this topic or an essay on that topic or whatever? And this process continued over the next several months. Ultimately, we found that we had gathered more essays than could be reasonably put into a single volume. As a result, we expanded Persistence of Polygamy into a 3-volume project. The first volume, as I mentioned, was originally published in 2010 under the subtitle Joseph Smith and the Origins of Mormon Polygamy. And it contained 8 never-before-published essays, each focusing on various aspects of polygamy as practiced and promoted by Mormonism's founder from the 1830s down until the time of his death in 1842. And then came Volume 2, From Joseph Smith's Martyrdom to the First Manifesto, and that carried the story of plural marriage forward to the crucial 1890 date when the LDS Church issued its first manifesto, and which purported to end the practice. But as we all know, that did not happen. There was and continues to be much more to the story, which of course is the basis of what's in Volume 1. It turned out a lot more than we had thought there would be as we put the volume together. Now, turning to the second question, how does our fundamentalist polygamy differ from the myriad of previously published volumes dealing with this same topic? Well, our work is unique in several respects. First and foremost, each of the 17 essays is an original, never-before-published essay reflecting current cutting-edge scholarship. The eclectic mix of authors range from established writers who have written extensively on the topic to younger scholars trained in the latest methodologies. A second thing that sets our volume apart is that each of the essays in our work deals with issues and or individuals either overlooked and or not adequately examined in previous studies. This is reflected in the volume's content, which opens with a fine foreword written by Bridget Cook-Burch, and she'll say more about that. And as I mentioned, the first essay by Barbara Jones Brown focuses on the twilight of mainstream Mormon polygamy in Mexico during the late 19th century and early 20th, and it's provocatively entitled Manifestos, Mixed Messages, and Mexico. I love the title. And equally provocative is Brian's essay, which deals on John Taylor's 1886 revelation. Carefully considering moving on to the essays that come after that are 2 essays considering the origins of fundamentalist Mormonism during the early 20th century, and written by a pair of very competent scholars and experts on this topic, namely Christopher James Blythe back there and Marianne Timson Watson. Following are 3 essays exploring the lives and activities of 4 important, crucial fundamentalist leaders who played a very crucial role in shaping the movement during the course of the 20th century. The first was Joseph White Musser, a leader of the fundamentalist community, but also more than that, a propagandist by virtue of his role as publisher of Truth magazine. That essay was authored by Kenneth Driggs, who unfortunately couldn't be with us tonight. He lives back in Atlanta, Georgia. The second leader considered, the fundamentalist leader is considered, is Rulon C. Allred, who was the prime mover and figure in the emergence of the Bluffdale-based Apostolic United Brethren. And he's considered in a very carefully researched and written essay by Eric Paul Rogers and by co-authored by Carol Roche. And she couldn't be with us either tonight. The father and son, and finally rounding out this foursome or this quartet, are the father and son team of Rulon and Warren Jeffs, who together shaped the Colorado-based FLDS church into the cult-like movement that it became during the late 20th century. And the two Jeffs are the subject of that essay was written by Craig Foster and myself. And then we've got a series of five essays that explore several controversial and often overlooked topics. Particularly path-breaking, and I find very intriguing, is Shannon E. Spafford's essay, The Changing, I like this title too, The Changing and Unchanging Nature of Fundamentalist Mormon Clothing Styles. And she provides a very illuminating analysis of this, and this is really path-breaking. Now, the second essay in this section is co-authored by Craig and myself, and it deals with the 1980 schism within fundamentalist Mormonism. And then a third essay deals with a more recent event that all of us remember, but now it's history, so because it's in our volume, it's the 2008 Texas raid on the FLDS Yearning for Zion Ranch. I authored that one. And then I also authored a third essay in this section on fundamentalist Mormon beliefs on race and African Americans. They take a pre-1978 view of the place and the role of blacks within from their perspective. Now, Craig Foster has dealt with another really kind of important path-breaking topic in his Plural Wives of Fundamentalist Mormon Leaders, and he'll have more to say about his exhaustively researched and carefully written essay. Also illuminating are three essays providing a personal perspective on fundamentalist Mormonism. Joseph Lyman Jessup, who couldn't be with us tonight either, He recalls and recollects on growing up in one of the polygamous communities of Pinedale, Montana, a very vivid personal recollection. Marianne Watson, a member of the Apostolic United Brethren, provides a carefully written analysis in an essay, Polygamous Ancestry of Contemporary Fundamentalist Mormons. And well-known fundamentalist activist Ann Wild has examined section 132 of the Doctrine and Covenants from a fundamentalist Mormon perspective. And she couldn't be with us tonight, but she left a copy of her remarks, which I'll probably end up reading it, or one of us will arm wrestle over who's going to read it. Okay, then there's two concluding essays that explore the topic of plural marriage from a broader perspective. One of these is Craig Foster's essay entitled Modern Media Stereotyping of Polygamy, which and then the final essay in the volume, written by Todd Compton, who also couldn't be with us, and co-author Pat Lynn Scott, entitled, and I love this title too, you know, it seems like the women who come up with the greatest titles, Wrestling with the Principle, a historical biography of modern polygamy. Now, Craig will now speak, and then he will be followed by the contributors in the order that I indicated. Let's see. Let's try to, you know, maybe you can reach that. I can't see it. You did it.
Can you hear me well enough? Okay. All right. When Newell Bringhurst and I did our book signing for the first volume of the Persistence of Polygamy series back in 2011, I told about my family's connection to plural marriage. I explained that my great-grandmother was my great-grandfather's fifth wife, and my grandmother, his 26th child out of 30. I grew up well aware of plural marriage as it was discussed repeatedly in our home and at family gatherings. My mother hated plural marriage because of what her mother and grandmother had to go through. When my grandmother was born in 1892, a warrant was issued for my great-grandfather's arrest. A warrant was also issued for my great-grandmother, as they wanted her to testify against her husband. Not knowing for sure my great-grandmother's name, the warrant read Jane Doe Chambers, which was not my great-grandmother's maiden name, but instead a family name from a generation or so back. I can only assume that she had used that name as an alias at one point or another to avoid being apprehended by the law. After a time of trying to avoid arrest, my great-grandfather eventually turned himself in, and the case was ultimately thrown out by the judge. Nevertheless, the pain and resentment of how they were treated continued to be expressed by members of my family. Because of these and other difficult experiences, my mother hated plural marriage and readily said so, and quite often. And then she almost always followed that up with a comment that she knew it was a true doctrine and was from God. So that is the milieu in which I grew up. Because of this background, which I might add, are my only polygamous ancestors. I often joke that my wife's family makes up for my dearth of polygamous ancestors. But anyway, I became interested in the history of Mormon polygamy from a young age, and during my teens I read quite a bit about it, along with other aspects of church history. As an undergraduate, I wrote about plural marriage. I again addressed it in my master's thesis, now the book with the incredibly long title that scares people away, as well as other publications, articles, and such. But I did not address it in depth until Newell and I decided to do the Persistence of Polygamy series. These past 5 to 6 years or so, actually I think closer to 7, have been an odyssey of hard work, a little frustration here and there, of discovery and memorable and unforgettable experiences. We've worked with some of the best and most knowledgeable scholars working in the field of Mormon history, and we have also encouraged and given publishing opportunities to some young scholars, a few of whom who have gone on and are earning well-deserved reputations in the field of Mormon history. It has been an honor and privilege to work with these many scholars from all 3 volumes and to have addressed fascinating topics that have shed new light on plural marriage. Newell and I have also done our own research and writing. We worked together on a few essays, some of which Newell mentioned, and have each written a good handful on our own. For example, in this volume, I am both proud of and nervous about my essay on the wives of the fundamentalist leaders. As I mentioned in the beginning of the essay, that it was kind of like trying to hit a moving target in terms of trying to track down the names of and verify these names of the wives of the various fundamentalist leaders. And it was an extremely difficult essay to research and write as I tried to identify all of the wives of these various men. I conducted a number of interviews of children and grandchildren of these leaders, searched documents, as well as genealogical charts and websites, and hoped I was getting it all down correctly. That is why I'm so nervous about it. I'm sure that I probably have missed one or two of Warren's wives. Okay, more than one or two. But I did my best. In the process of our research, Newell and I have traveled many miles and visited with a lot of people. We have repeatedly been welcomed into people's homes and conducted numerous interviews. We have visited Hilldale and Colorado City so many times that the young women who work in the Merry Wives Cafe in Hilldale recognize us. When we go in, they just kind of smile at us like, oh, you're here again. And they have very good food. So if you ever get down there, great food at the Merry Wives Cafe. Along with Hilldale and Colorado City, we have also visited Centennial Park, Pinesdale, Montana, Rocky Ridge, Bluffdale, and a number of other places. We have had incredible, almost surreal experiences, like being in Colorado City the day Warren Jeffs was sentenced to life in prison, and interviewing one of Warren's brothers who announced he was glad that his brother was sentenced to life in prison. He deserved it. And I'm putting it the mild way. He kind of expressed it a little more strongly. Then there was also another time that we held an interview into the early morning hours, sitting in what the FLDS leaders called their war room, surrounded by walls lined with binders with information about apostates and critics, and also whiteboards filled with court dates and legal strategies. Oh, how I wish that I had a little teeny camera that I could have taken pictures of some of that. And then on another visit, Steve Mayfield and I walked through the elementary school that had been transformed by FLDS leaders into an interview and indoctrination place, and heard Willie Jessup talk about what had gone on there. We then visited the plush homes built by the sweat and toil of the faithful for Warren Jeffs, believing, as he had promised them, that if they finished the homes by midnight on New Year's Eve, the Texas prison walls would crumble down and Warren would be escorted out by angels. I guess the angels never came. He's still there. I personally will never forget these and other powerful experiences, and they really were. Some of them were extremely powerful. These interesting experiences in the three volumes, notwithstanding, for me, and I think Newell would agree, what will be the most important outcome of this project are the friendships we have created. We have met so many people and have been touched and impressed by the faith, dedication, sincerity, friendliness, and generosity of many we have met. We can truly say we have created some lifelong friendships we will always cherish. The principle and all that is involved was not easy for the early saints, and it continues to not be easy for the modern adherents, our fundamentalist cousins. I think my mother reflected the attitude of many modern Latter-day Saints who dislike, are bothered by, certainly do not fully understand, and yet accept the doctrine of plural marriage as a divine principle. No, plural marriage was not, and it is not, an easy thing to practice. And as for myself, I started so long ago as a teenager in trying to figure out plural marriage. I will continue to study and will no doubt write and publish more about a principle that I grew up hearing about and have spent and will spend a number of years trying to better understand. Thanks.
You have to watch or they commandeer you. So I'm delighted to be here tonight. I have an incredible amount of respect for these two particular scholars and editors and compilation artists. I also have a great deal of respect for the people who are in this room who actually put together the essays that went in this volume and in the volumes previous to this. In the foreword, I talk a little bit about meeting these two for the first time. And it was very interesting because I was working on a book called The Witness Wore Red about the 19th wife who brought polygamous cult leader Warren Jeffs and others to justice. And it was quite interesting because in the process of it, I was having to do a tremendous amount of research on Mormon fundamentalism as far as the FLDS were concerned, and then everything that was going on in the Hilldale area, everything that was going on in Texas, including 450 boxes of evidence and many, many, many terabytes of digital information, plus Rebecca Musser's life story. And then we had Mitt Romney going up for a presidential nomination at the same time as Warren Jeffs was going into trial and most of America not understanding the difference between their beliefs. And so it was important to be able to address that. However, so I'll just give you a tiny little bit of background about me because I don't have the same scholarly insight as some of you do. I grew up Catholic in Brigham City, Utah. And then I became a convert to the church after a near-death experience in my early 20s. So I have enough guilt to be a Jewish princess. And when I was working on The Witness Wore Red, so I went to do research on just polygamy. And other topics that I had covered, I'm used to covering extreme topics. So I've written about a former skinhead who changed his life. He's actually a convert to the LDS church. Also the daughter of a serial killer who is a convert to the LDS church. So I'm used to these rather extreme stories, and I'm not afraid to broach topics. However, polygamy was one of those areas that many people did not want to talk about. And I would find this pendulum swing. So over here, we have those who were very pro-polygamy, and they were the first to tell you all about polygamy and how, you know, it was a principle that had been denied and all of this. And then on the other side were the anti-polygamists. It was very difficult for me to find something in the middle that absolutely cherished and honored all sides of the spectrum until I met these two gentlemen. And so it was a great pleasure for me to run into them. And I kind of bowed down and said, "Hallelujah, I found you and your scholars." And I began to do much more intensive research based on what some of you, including Brian Hales and others, have put together on the topics of polygamy. And it was really refreshing because my work is about the human side of the story. My work is about what principles and politics and people do to one another, and also if someone has been through the depths of hell, how they come out on the other side and are able to be contributions to society. In these essays, we're able to see that over and over again. Extraordinary people going through extraordinary things, taking a stand wherever they felt was necessary and honorable to them, and then being able to share it with the rest of the world. So it was my pleasure and honor to be able to do the foreword, and I honestly hope that this entire series of articles and information actually gets out there in a wider way. As I go into wards and other things, it's kind of interesting to, like Brigham Young, it took me 2 years and six sets of missionaries to join the church. And it was actually when I spoke with sister missionaries about polygamy that I finally felt like I could let the dust settle enough to join the church, until later. This is a topic I think that no one has exhaustively explored, and I'm not sure that anyone, until we get to the other side, will have all of the answers. And yet, it is really fascinating to be able to read your essays and to be able to understand perspectives from all across the board. So I would just like to say I've been very honored to be a part of this. I'm grateful for the raw honesty and the incredible scholarly work that you put into this, and just grateful to be here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Can you hear me? I'm Barbara Jones Brown, and I want to join with Bridget in expressing my appreciation to Newell and Craig for inviting me to participate in this volume. It doesn't seem that long ago that I was sitting right here listening to them present about volume two. And so it was exciting after that to be invited to share my work in volume three. Because of the number of presenters here tonight, I'm just going to briefly give an overview about my essay, and hopefully you will read it. The title, as Newell mentioned, is Manifestos, Mixed Messages, and Mexico, The Demise of Mainstream Mormon Polygamy. So the mixed messages refers to what was going on between the public message that church leaders were sharing and privately what they were teaching to church members. I became interested in this topic after writing about the Anson Bowen Call family, who began in the 1880s living in northern Utah, in Bountiful, Utah, as a monogamous couple, but they desired to follow the principle, as it was called, to be worthy of the highest degree of the celestial kingdom. And so, believing the church leaders' teaching that polygamy was essential for salvation, they chose to enter into this order of marriage in spite of increasing federal legislation against polygamy. And it follows their journey from Bountiful to Star Valley, where Anson takes his second wife, and then down to, or becomes engaged to his second wife, and then down to Mexico when President Wilford Woodruff advises them to go there to be sealed in the temple after they're denied the opportunity to be sealed in Logan because of this anti-polygamy legislation that has just come out. So that was, of course, the 1890 manifesto was when that was first taking place. And the thing that first confused me was that Woodruff advises Anson to go to Mexico to be married polygamously as he is simultaneously issuing the 1890 manifesto. So that was the first time I started to be confused and have questions. Again, just briefly, they go to Mexico, and I follow what church leaders are teaching in Mexico and teaching to the people there compared to what they are teaching publicly or what they are saying publicly and teaching to the monogamous section of the church, which by then was in the United States. My argument is that because of confusion and disagreement that existed between the First Presidency and the Quorum of the Twelve, they're not coming together to agree on whether or not they should write these manifestos, the second being in 1904. It created confusion and disagreement among church members as well, especially those who were living polygamously in Canada and Mexico. I believe that what I found in my research shows that the church leaders actually never intended to fully end polygamy in 1890 or 1904. Rather, they were issuing these manifestos until the political winds changed and this blew over, and then they could go back to living this principle fully that they, again, believed was required to achieve salvation. So I'll just read a couple of quotes, and then I will leave the rest of the time to my fellow contributors here tonight. 6 months after the manifesto, and again, this is after Woodruff was advising people who were already engaged to be married polygamously to go to Mexico, Woodruff privately told his counselors and apostles that the, quote, principle of plural marriage will be restored to this church, but how or when, I cannot say. Of the same meeting, Apostle Heber J. Grant recorded that Woodruff told them that God will yet open doors that the principle of plural marriage can and will be restored. After the second manifesto, colloquially called in 1904, President Joseph F. Smith goes to visit the saints who were living in Mexico, who were living in polygamy, who are obviously confused by the second manifesto as well, because it says you'll be excommunicated if you're participating in it. He goes to the Mormon Mexican colonies and says, quote, there are no plural marriages being formed at present in the church, in Mexico or anywhere else. He says this in a Juarez stake priesthood meeting. Be true to your wives and your children. that God has given you, for God will hold you responsible. But men cannot marry plural wives at present with my consent, nor the consent of the church. The church is upon trial before the government of the United States, and we must be very careful. Again, this is just during the Reed Smoot trials in Washington, D.C. Smith's repeated use of the words at present, along with his citing the ongoing Smoot trial as the reason the church needed to be very careful, suggests he was probably also keeping the door open to authorize plural marriages when this controversy passed. The remainder of my essay goes into the Mexican Revolution and how the violence of the revolution forced many of these polygamous Mormons who were living in northern Mexico to flee back across the United States, where because of anti-polygamy prosecution, they break up. These families that were polygamous break up and start living separately, except for a small handful of people who chose to remain in Mexico in spite of the violence. Anyways, again, I am just really honored to have participated with my fellow contributors, and am grateful to Craig and Newell for inviting me here tonight. And thank you to Benchmark Books.
I, too, am very grateful to Newell and Craig for allowing me to have participated with several of these volumes, but I should mention that my contribution to Volume 2 was as a co-author with Don Bradley, and I don't think any person contributed a whole chapter to any of them, did they? But I was able to at least contribute in a small way, and I appreciate that. They've been very patient with me. I'm really not that good of a writer, but they're good editors, so it's worked out. My chapter is on the 1886 Revelation, and that is a controversial document, to be sure. It's controversial theologically. It's controversial historically. And I think we get lost sometimes in the theological interpretations, but as I go through this chapter, I point out that it's also very important from a historical standpoint, because in 1929, Lauren Woolley signed a statement. And in that statement, he described three events that had occurred back on September 27th, a Monday, 1886. And the three events were, one, there was an eight-hour meeting with 13 people in attendance. And during that meeting, according to the statement, John Taylor rose above the floor, declared, "I would never sign a manifesto." It's the kind of meeting you would never forget. And the second event was that the revelation was dictated in that meeting, according to Lauren Woolley. Now, we have another provenance for the revelation, and they're not mutually exclusive, and I go through that in the book, but according to the statement, it was dictated. And then the last event that was significant, and you could argue it's the most significant event in the history of Mormon fundamentalism, was that after that meeting, five men were given authority to continue the polygamy independent of what the church should choose to do. And what's interesting from a historical standpoint is as church leaders, Heber G. Grant and others, and Heber G. Grant was related actually to some of these people, to the Woolley family, they came out and tried to attack the reality of the revelation. And it was the one thing of those three that the fundamentalists could show without any question that it existed. And I believe that had they instead drawn question about the eight-hour meeting or about these ordinations, which are described in somewhat ambiguous terms, that they might have actually had a little more success in rebutting the claims of the fundamentalists that were published in 1932 and then got traction throughout the 1930s. So it's somewhat ironic, and my conclusion is that the LDS church leadership might have been a lot smarter to just say, here's the revelation, here's what it says. Mike Quinn has observed it really doesn't say anything that hadn't been said in other revelations of the 1880s. But instead, they fought against it, they tried to hide it and called it a scrap of paper and things. And what's happened among the fundamentalists is that they would see that this is a real revelation, and then they would, by inference, believe also that there's just as much evidence for the eight-hour meeting and the ordination of the five men occurring on that same date. And I outline that, and if I could go back and give counsel to President Heber J. Grant, I might just say, hey, look, just release it. Because that's what the church is doing today. They're becoming transparent. Don't try to hide things, and it might actually have worked out better. Thank you. I think Chris should bring up his oldest and just show this hairdo this kiddo's got.
Oh, I wish I
could. Fantastic.
I wish he could, I could, but you might have heard his tantrum as he made his way out. So, it's great to be here. I'm really excited to see this volume in print. And I think they mentioned so many great things this volume does. You know, it's kind of unusual of a volume of this size and a topic that's not absolutely mainstream. But I think it's exciting that we have authors, particularly authors that are sometimes from a fundamentalist background, which I'm not, but right there with the rest of the voices. I think that's the important contribution this volume makes. What I'm looking at is a movement, in fact, two movements that occur before the Woolley movement, which most of this volume will be about. 1929, a little before, we have Lauren Woolley setting up throughout till the end of his lifetime what we can kind of think of as a systematized and orthodox version of Mormon fundamentalism. The Lauren Woolley story, and understanding that Joseph Smith is the one mighty and strong who in a resurrected state will set in order the house of God, and understanding a moderate understanding of the church is still a legitimate institution that has some things that need to be worked out, and the priesthood as being something separate. Well, before this happens, movements begin to prosper really around 1904, and they prosper not because of the 1890 manifesto, but because of the Reed-Smoot hearing. In 1904, at the Reed-Smoot hearing, not only did eventually Joseph F. Smith issue the second manifesto that really put an end to plural marriage, made a penalty if one entered into it, but he also made a statement. And that statement was that he had never received a revelation. This is important. Joseph F. Smith will later say to the church, look, this isn't what I meant. Of course, I've had revelations, but they wanted to know had I ever had a written, what Terrell Givens would call a dialogical revelation. Have I ever written something? Have I ever told a vision to the church? And I haven't done that. Well, the response, and we actually have a few letters in the Joseph F. Smith papers, where people wrote him and said, wait, I'm really bothered by what you said here. You're the prophet. Why are you saying you didn't have revelation? In some cases, in two cases, we had men, two cases that I focus on in my essay, many more than this, actually, say, well, something's wrong in the church so much that it needs to be fixed. In 1876, a revelation that Joseph Smith had, it's today is in the 85th section of the Doctrine and Covenants, talks about the one mighty and strong coming forth. Well, people from 1876 have, and before, but particularly in Utah after 1876, have looked to this sort of messianic figure, the one mighty and strong, to fix things. So my essay looks at two individuals who claim to have this position. One, John T. Clark, who Brian Hales has written some about, and another, Samuel Eastman. Samuel Eastman's a really interesting individual because he's a German convert, German immigrant to the church, most of his followers are German immigrants, he's actually from England, comes to Utah, has all sorts of great experiences, which he writes about, and eventually says he's had this revelation, he's the one mighty and strong. And when he hears that statement from Joseph F. Smith, says, all right, now's the time to act. His movement doesn't ever take off too much, but they're interesting because they bear a lot in common with later fundamentalism. The church is legitimate in an extent, but because the righteous who want to live these principles, particularly consecration for Eastman, are being excommunicated and not to feel welcome in average meeting house, he's going to set up what he calls a branch of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints where they can be safe. Story becomes really fascinating with both these individuals. And so what my essay does is just examine why they had such an appeal at that time, why were there one mighty and strongs, and how the church tries to respond to that, particularly in 1905 when they issue a statement condemning this belief and practice. So I hope you read the essay. Thank you.
my son had an accident. He broke his back on his riding his four-wheeler a couple weeks ago, and so I have not written anything, so I will try to be brief. I have two essays in the book. When I went to Israel about almost 20 years ago, our tour guide joked that where there are two Jews, there are three opinions. Of course, I have glomped onto that. I believe that wherever there are two fundamentalists, there are three opinions. Further, I believe that where there are two Mormons, there are three opinions about polygamy. My first essay is about three contemporary men that wrote journals and wrote about their conversion to fundamentalist, what we call fundamentalist Mormonism. Back then it didn't have that name. They just referred to it as the fullness of the gospel, or terms like that, or even old-fashioned Mormonism. And they write about it, and in my essay, I use their journals, and truly, the person that got me started on this was my grandfather, whose name was Joseph Lyman Jessup, who is not the same Joseph Lyman Jessup who has an essay in this book. He is another grandson that carries his name. But I was asked at age 19 to, by my grandmother, to transcribe my grandfather's journals. That was a life-changing beginning of a lifetime change. I never dreamed when I was in high school that I'd ever be a historian. I was very happy being a mother, but this compelled me. And I went back to college to become a historian. And meanwhile, I also, because of my grandmother, once again, became very interested in genealogy. And it happened to be my grandfather's line that I focused on. And so it seems that, so I am now a genealogist and a historian. And that's what I do. And I've found that the two go very well hand in hand. It's helped me to flesh out things that would otherwise be very difficult to flesh out, just looking at it, sometimes from a historical point or just from a family history point. And so I have found these journals to be extremely interesting. I hope to be publishing some of them in the future that I have access to, that no one else does. And I also am very interested in biography and also the reasons why people do things. I think that fundamentalists are especially prone to oral tradition because they do not have access to the records as many historians in the church do, and I love the papers that are coming out, the Joseph Smith Project, that gives greater access. And so I like to be able to read the diaries of these people because they coincide so closely with what I grew up knowing by oral tradition. And I can honestly say that much of it has been very, very consistent as I have studied it and studied their lives. I can also say that there are many traditions among fundamentalists that I can't find any evidence for. For instance, saying that there seemed to be a relationship between President Joseph F. Smith and John Woolley, but I can't find where there's an exact... Some fundamentalists like to say that John Woolley was appointed by Joseph F. Smith. I haven't found evidence, but the theology brings out another point, so that's a discussion for another day. My second essay was just for fun, but it ended up being something that I learned from. I just wanted to do, I kept noticing, I have hundreds of clients that I do genealogy for, and both in and out of the church, in fundamentalists, Catholics, everybody. And so I thought I'd do this project because I kept tripping over the same names in doing fundamentalist research. Oh, they were from early church history. Oh, making drawing the line. So I decided to do a project studying out who had fundamentalist ancestry, or rather early Mormon polygamist ancestry, and who did not. And I just took, I did a kind of a random survey, and I decided to ask people questions. And so it was very interesting. There were many that had a lot of early Mormon polygamist ancestry, and then there were generations of no polygamy, but there were some that had consistent polygamy from Joseph Smith to the present day. And then, of course, there were the converts that didn't have any. But the attitudes were interesting, and I noticed a pattern as I did these pedigree charts and I counted the number of polygamist ancestors. I literally made a pedigree chart for each one and then counted the number of polygamist ancestors on each chart. And it only goes back so far, of course, 7, sometimes 8 generations. What I noticed was, simple fact, everybody knows that you have two parents, four grandparents, 8 great-grandparents, etc. What I noticed was that for those that continued in plural marriage, there was no cessation, their polygamous ancestry was twice as much, 3 times as much as people that didn't wherever there was a break or a cessation. And that fact was really stunning. One girl that I interviewed, because she had had me do her chart, and never knew who her grandfather was until we found out, and she found out that he came from a very blue blood line of Mormonism, Lydia Knight, some of the first members of the church. She said to me, and she came from a broken family. She said to me, "I do not know what I would do if I could not live this way." Well, when I went to St. George, she was unmarried at that time, and since married as a plural wife. When I went to St. George, it was suggested down there in one of the papers that it was stated that the pattern was that women, daughters of polygamists, tend to live or enter plural marriage, and daughters of monogamists tended to marry monogamously. And this fit in exactly with my research. The more polygamous ancestors people tended to have, the more likely it was that they would enter plural marriage, which I thought was an interesting commentary. I could take it a lot further, but there could be some conclusions drawn or some postulations. I don't know about that. I did want to make a comment about why women in particular live plural marriage. My grandmother, my other grandmother, had her first husband died when my dad was 6 months old, and then she married in plurally in a family that had at least 5 wives, and that family eventually broke up, and she chose at age 70 to marry Ruin C. Allred. And I believe she's named in Craig's article. She said to me, I got out of one, and then, oh, I forgot, she had another marriage where the man died suddenly, and she was only married to him for a short period of time, but it was quite a loveless marriage. So she had some experience in marriage. And she said, "I decided that I didn't know whether I could make a marriage work or not. And I chose to marry Rulon because I had to know before God that I could make a marriage work. And she had a delightful marriage with him. He treated and honored and respected her as the kind of man he was, and she truly loved him and made her happy. Decided to go into it. And so the one thing that I can say is that when we were in Casper, Wyoming, talking about the handcart company's disasters, and I've heard the story all my life, perhaps many of you have, about discussions that were held in the early days after that incident, and the man that stood up and said, "You don't know what we've been through. You can't judge." They were discussing who to blame for the handcart disaster. And he said, "You don't know what we've been through. We came to know our God on the plains of Wyoming. And we will not trade that for anything." And so I know that a lot of people that live plural marriage today, despite the hardships, that is what's in their heart. It is a matter of knowing their God, despite all the hardships and heartache that sometimes it brings, the social repercussions. That I wanted to share with you.
Yeah, I'm Eric Rogers, and appreciate so much Newell and Craig. I appreciate what Marianne had to say about Rulon Allred. I have to say I'm a Rulon Allred fan. I admire him a great deal. We differ on a number of points, but I admire what he's done. And knowing some of his children and grandchildren, I think that reflects very positively on Rulon C. Allred. One of the great experiences that I've had in working on this project is the relationships that I've been able to develop with Newell, with Craig, with my co-author Carrie Ruchet, and with Joe Jessup, with whom I've collaborated for a number of years. In 2006, I moved from Utah to Hamilton, Montana. I'm a Latter-day Saint, mainstream Latter-day Saint, and I was invited to a ward party. And at this ward party, I met Joe Jessup, and he said he was a polygamist. Well, he's in my ward, and he says he's a polygamist, and I didn't know quite what to make of that. And so I needed to learn more about Joe, and he really is both, I think. But that introduction into the community was very interesting. On another occasion, I served as the institute director for Seminaries and Institutes of Religion for the LDS Church at the University of Montana, and I had a young student. I actually had him for 4 years in institute. And he desperately wanted to serve a mission, but he was from Pinesdale, this polygamous community, and he also wanted 5 wives and 50 children. And I tried to help him see that those were incongruent. And eventually he did, and I think that he didn't go on a mission. I'll just put it that way. He went a different direction. While serving as a stake executive secretary, I got a phone call from a Baptist who said, "I've been studying the scriptures for 20 years, and I'm convinced that polygamy is ordained of God, and I want to learn more about it." He was calling the Stake Center for the LDS Church in Stevensville, Montana. And so, what would you do? Well, I called up Marvin Jessup, the leader of the polygamous community in Pinesdale, and said, "Marv, what do you want me to do with this guy?" He says, "If he's not LDS, we don't want anything to do with him. If he can't live that law, there's no way he can live the higher law." So I let Marv deal with it and just pass the information along. So I served a mission in Germany for 2 years for the LDS Church. I just want you to know that I'm also doing a little proselyting on the side for the polygamous community. As I learned that there were members of my ward who were former polygamists and former members of my ward who were current polygamists, I really became intrigued. And that's what led to my research with the help of Joe and others. And so I wonder, what are these fundamentalists doing in southwestern Montana in the community of Pinesdale? Why are they there? And that led to the research that's represented in my essay in Volume 3. And I'm just going to give you a few highlights or things to think about what's in my essay. First of all, I start with a look at Rulin Allred and his first marriage to Catherine Handy, who left Rulin in Long Beach after Rulin decided to enter into the principal. And I never heard her voice in the stories that I'd heard about Rulin. And I discovered that her diaries and journals were in special collections at BYU. And so I turned to those sources for much of the early part of my essay and encourage you to look there. Rulin called her Kitty, and it's quite a love story and quite a tragic end to their relationship. But she plays prominently in his life, and I think throughout his life, even after their divorce. I'm quite confident, too, from her diaries that Rulin continued to be in her heart throughout her life. And as I understand it, Catherine and Craig's mother were friends in Visalia, which is where Catherine passed away, I think is where she's buried. Number two, I look at the Allred's transition from mainstream Mormonism to fundamentalism, and that's been treated elsewhere. But it was an important context for why fundamentalism made it into Montana. In 1955, in July, Rulin and his seven families, who were living at 13th East and 48th South in Murray, were tipped off that they were going to be raided by the police. This is in 55, so it's just 2 years after the Short Creek raids. And so Rulin scattered his families to the wind, and some of them ended up in Montana. And so I tell that story about the influences, the factors that led to the diaspora of the Allred group at that time, and really looking for a place of refuge. And so the title is Rulin C. Allred, The Search for Refuge. And they really did find that refuge in southwestern Montana. I look at some of the dynamics between the fundamentalist, LDS, and larger community, and at the conclusion of my essay, I hint at the current tensions and what I'm quite confident will be a substantial split in the AUB over leadership that's playing out right now as we speak. I'm grateful for the opportunity to have participated in the project, and thank you for all for coming. I hope you'll read the essay. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Shannon. This is a lot more people than I thought there'd be, so that's nerve-wracking. My dad called me on Sunday and just said, for warning, you're going to have to give a 5-minute presentation. And I feel like I definitely didn't prepare as much as other people. He just said, how did I start this and what were the most interesting things while I was in the process of researching? And I got off the phone and my husband and I were actually laughing about it because this started before we had even met, and we've been married 2 years. So it's been a long process. I've been researching about polygamy longer than I've known him, so that's odd. But anyway, so I went to BYU and I got my history degree, and I actually concentrated on the Civil War. That was my main area of study, and especially social issues during the Civil War. So this is a big deviation from what I had always done before. And I honestly don't even remember how I got started. My dad and I were just talking about it one night, and it went from there. But the most interesting thing in my article that I've been thinking about is how the FLDS in particular dressed like mainstream Americans in the 50s, and it was the Short Creek Raid in 59 that really 53 that really changed things, and after that they started getting more conservative. And I thought it was interesting how under Rulin and Warren Jeffs, how the changes in their dress code were very gradual. It started out that you can't wear shorts anymore for dresses. No red in the dresses, no flowers, no patterns. It was all very, very gradual, and eventually to the point where there was a specific dress pattern that was passed around from woman to woman in the FLDS community. So not only could they not wear flowers or plaid, like, you have to make your dress in this pattern. And I just, that was the most interesting thing to me, was just by degrees how it got more and more stringent. And honestly, that's all I came prepared with. I didn't come as well prepared as the other people, but I really enjoyed researching this. It was definitely different for me, and I feel very honored to be counted among these amazing scholars. So that's all. Thank you.
So me?
Yeah, you're next.
Okay. I promise to be short on this matter. I am very honored to have been asked to co-author this chapter with Todd Compton. So I want to thank Newell and Craig for this honor. When I first was asked, I was reluctant because I was busy. I didn't know if I really wanted to do it. But working with Todd Compton is quite a pleasure. We're sort of opposites. He's organized, I'm not. I'm a real procrastinator, and he is timely. The one thing we have together is that we both are bibliographers, and that we work hard. My adage has always been, why do it today when you can wait until tomorrow? So you've got a person like Todd Compton who would keep me on track. What I should say, I'm Pat Scott, so if you don't know that, but I do want to say this is the final essay in the book, and it's a bibliographic essay. Todd wanted to make certain that I got the point across that it's only scraping the surface. It is a bibliographic essay. It's looking at historical periods. I've been a bibliographer looking at polygamy since the 1970s. I went to a Utah Historical Society annual meeting. I heard Eugene Campbell and his wonderful article on divorce. And that caught my interest. I did an article in the Journal of Mormon History that updated Davis Bitten's bibliography on polygamy. And since then, I have been doing bibliographies. I've been updating it. There was envision to do an article looking at everything that's been written in the 20th century. And it never came to fruition. So I have a binder that is over 120 pages of just listing of materials. But it has been a real pleasure to work on this. I do encourage you to look at our essay and to use it. Bibliographies are used not to just sit there and gather dust. For those of you that may not have, that may want to read the literature, this is a good place to start. What are some of the best things for certain periods of time? So that's me. Thank you.
Thanks. I guess I'm going to assume the role of Ann Wild, who couldn't be with us tonight. She's actually, I'm very envious of her because she's up in the Northeast going and looking and traveling through the fall colors and up through New England. And so she says, greetings from the Northeast, the land of brilliant fall colors, where I'm enjoying a road trip with three fun cousins.
Our trip was planned before the date of this book signing was scheduled. Otherwise, I would have tried to make other arrangements. However, the following written comments will have to take the place of my speaking in person. As an independent fundamentalist Mormon, a plural wife for 33 years, and an advocate for plural marriage between consenting adults for several decades, I was honored to be asked to submit an essay on Doctrine and Covenants, Section 132, from a fundamentalist perspective. My essay begins with a definition of terms, showing that plural marriage, celestial marriage, new and everlasting covenant of marriage, and patriarchal order of marriage were all used interchangeably in the beginning years of the LDS Church. Included in the brief history of Section 132, I quote the four different section headings for 132, with changes occurring in 1876, 1921, 1979, 2013. In explaining the difference between a priesthood law and a church law, I found it interesting that in Section 132, the word law is mentioned 32 times, whereas the church, the term church, is not mentioned at all. I review the importance of Section 132 by using additional scripture and quotes from early church leaders on a variety of other subjects discussed in this section. About the fullness of the gospel, how to return to God's presence, how man can become a god, conditions for remarriage, etc. It is significant to note that from 1940 on to the present, the word of recommended questions about plural marriage has become more specific and increasingly incriminating six different times, as shown from the exact wording I have included. Fascinating information on the identity of, quote, the one on the earth at a time, V7, verse 7, and the meaning of the law of Sarah, verses 34 and 65, is also included. Since there are both similarities and differences in the way fundamentalists perceive the contents of this important scripture, I decided to design and distribute a brief five-item questionnaire, which 120 believers of plural marriage completed. Various groups and independents are represented, with the exception of FLDS members, with the results tabulated and discussed at the end of my essay. Some answers are quite diverse, while others are very similar. This is not really very surprising, because fundamentalist Mormons, like mainstream Mormons and those of other religions, interpret their religious beliefs in many different ways. What fundamentalist Mormons do have in common, however, is a belief in Joseph Smith as a prophet and in the basic principles and doctrines that he taught, plural marriage being just one of them. My sincere thanks to Newell and Craig for the opportunity to participate in this significant work. I guess now is the book signing time. Questions. Yeah, okay, let's go for questions.
I think we've worn them all out.
Sterling?
Is there anyone that's paid particular attention to active communities of polygamists in Mexico? Anyone here? Are you aware of anyone that's researching that?
Yes and no. Marianne, would you like to answer that? Okay, good. I was waiting for you to say. I knew that you had done a lot, but wanted you to say it. So,
thank you. I'll talk with her.
Yeah. Gary.
Marianne raised the topic of divorce. what is the incidence of divorce? How is it viewed within the various communities?
Very good question, and we do not have an essay that actually deals with that, so see, we should have added about 30 more pages to that.
Do you have any impressions based on your own encounters with people?
With the FLDS, both marriage and divorce comes from the prophet. And, even those who want to get divorced, I mean, I guess if they pester enough, they could informally separate, but really Warren Jeffs controls both marriage, which is not taking place anymore right now, and divorce. With the Apostolic United Brethren, would one of you like to make a comment? Marianne?
I did a study in the late 1970s, early 1980s, of the polygamists in the Apostolic United Brethren. There were 143 polygamists, but I could count, and I knew everybody at that time. Among them, there were only three men who had a wife who had left them. That has changed. It reflects, I mean, it's more like mainstream society. I mean, there's many.
Yeah, okay.
But I don't think it's anywhere near the total rate of the of 50%. I think it's more like 30%.
Okay. Thank you. Very good.
This question is for Shannon. When you looked at the change of the clothing, did you look at the hairstyles?
I did. That's addressed.
Okay, cool.
There's a great picture in there, too.
Other questions? Anybody have any? We warn everybody out, I guess. It's been kind of a long session.
Oh, actually, yeah, for Eric, your co-author, is she a descendant of Thomas Ruche by chance?
I don't believe so. That's her married name.
That's okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I
wondered
that too. Okay, I guess that's it.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everybody, for coming. Bear with us for just a few minutes while we set up some